Welcome to Creation Magazine Live. We're going to take some articles from Creation Magazine and do a video version of them. You can follow along. There's a link on the website, and you can read the article with us and look up a lot of our other faith-building articles from Creation Magazine, our flagship publication.
That's right. We're just talking about a wide range of topics in Creation Magazine that all relate, of course, to the creation evolution issue and support the book of Genesis, which is really the seedbed of all Christian doctrine.
And so that's where everything starts, doesn't it? Everything begins in Genesis.
That's right. So the article we're talking about today is Unraveling the Knotty Khipu Code.
Gesundheit.
Exactly. Wow. But this is by Dr. David Catchpool from our Australian office. And this is an interesting article. It'll just get started here and you'll catch on to the... you know, the main concept here. He said, when I first heard pioneer creationist Professor Arthur Wilder Smith, who lived from 1915 to 1995, use the example of knots spaced along a rope according to a certain code, i.e. Morse code, something like that, to explain simply how information is stored in DNA, I thought it was a clumsy analogy. Who would ever think that a knotted rope could contain coded information? Shortly after that, I happened across a dictionary entry showing that someone had indeed not only already thought of it, long before Professor Wilder Smith, but it also put the idea into practice. Who? The Incas of South America. They stored information in the form of elaborate knotted strings known as khipu. Science historian Leland Locke worked out in the 1920s that the khipu were not merely decorative. He showed that they functioned as kind of textile abacus. They're knots used to store calculations. But Locke's breakthrough did not decode all of the estimated 600 khipu which survived the Spanish conquest. In recent decades, it became increasingly evident that many of the khipu were clearly non-numerical, with some researchers suggesting that the Incan knotted strings may have been a written language. And now, Harvard University's Gary Urton, professor of pre-Columbian studies, has identified that the Incas stored information in the khipu according to a complex binary code more than 500 years before modern computers were invented. So they're taking these, ropes, and they're actually tying knots and storing information on them, which is an interesting concept. And we'll get into the whole concept of information.
And the article has a picture of an example of that there.
That's right. And as I'm looking at the picture here, it wouldn't come to mind right away that that has a lot of information in it. It just looks like a rope with some, you know, somebody knotted together some things. Anyway, we'll talk more about it.
Yes.
The six binary choices include the direction of the knot, forward or reverse, the spin and the ply of the string, the type of material, whether it was cotton or wool, and so on. With 24 string colors to choose from, each knot could encode one of 1,536 possible information units. This is somewhat more than the estimated 1,000 to 1,500 Sumerian cuneiform symbols and more than twice the number of Egyptian hieroglyphic signs. But at this stage, Urton still had not yet completely cracked the khipu code. To do that would require the discovery of a document in a known language matched to a khipu. That is something similar to the Rosetta Stone, which enabled Egyptian hieroglyphics to be deciphered. In the meantime, he is using 21st century technology to search for common patterns in the knotted cords in an attempt to uncover further information stored in the khipu code. When Urton discovered three khipu that shared part of the information, he explained that this is pretty strong evidence that they're not made by a single people. On the contrary, they were a shared code. This evidence of sharing is a sophisticated and mathematically complex code by the Incas makes a mockery of the ideas that early people were primitive and unsophisticated. Instead, the Incas obviously had a highly integrated and functioning civilization and were clearly highly intelligent and inventive, as evidenced by their ingenious khipu. But in fact, the sophisticated storing of information on segments of threaded strands according to a certain code already existed before the Incas invented the khipu, of course, for the principle was embedded into their very own genes, strands of DNA, which has successfully carried the information to build the entire human body from generation to generation ever since the creation of the first man and woman. So God thought of it. And if anyone reading this should doubt that God exists, consider this. Code systems have only ever come from intelligence. Matter, by itself, never produces code. As the khipu code is an indicator of its inventor's intelligence, so the DNA code is an indicator of its inventor's intelligence. Far more information-rich than the khipu. DNA could never have risen from matter by itself, and the information embedded in DNA had to come from somewhere. In the beginning, there had to be information. In the beginning, there had to be intelligence. In the beginning, God, which is exactly how...
Just Genesis. That's how the Bible starts, you know, and that logically and scientifically and from everything that we can observe, like the article says,
right.
Information comes from intelligence.
Right.
And we've used this example many times. If you walk along a beach in the summertime and you see Johnny Loves Susie written there in the sand, you know that that information didn't come from the properties of the water washing up on the beach.
Right, and doesn't come from the natural properties in sand. You can take a bucket of sand, you look at the sand, there's no information in there. But if it's arranged in a certain way, just like the khipu code, you know, I get a piece of rope, there's no information in it. You know, even if there's some knots in the rope, that's not information to me. But if you have a translation device for that particular code, and that code has been, those knots have been arranged in a certain way, it can contain information, yes. But the information never came from the matter or energy that it's carried upon. And this is a fascinating topic, I think, the whole information argument, or even just the concept of information, where it comes
yes.
from, how it's
yeah.
stored, the fact that it's not a material entity.
Yeah, it's the arrangement of matter by intelligence, and a code has been placed on the arrangement of that matter, whether it's sand on the beach
right.
or chalk on a chalkboard. Like you said, the information isn't in the matter.
Yep.
It's when something intelligent acts on the matter to arrange it in a particular way and put a code in there, like the knots. And this is fascinating. I don't remember actually reading this article
right.
before. I must have missed it somehow.
To be honest, the whole information argument, I was out doing ministry on the weekend, and somebody asked me, you know, what's the strongest argument? They were asking me what I believe what was one of the strongest arguments for creation. And,
right.
and I used this argument. I said, I think this is one of the most challenging things for evolutionists to explain. And even many evolutionists have said, you know, like Dr. Paul Davies, who said, well, there's no known process where matter can create information. He's just saying we've never seen it once. So science being totally dependent, of course, or not totally dependent, but it should be highly dependent on observable evidence. If every case we've ever seen information, you know, where it was created from, has always come from an intelligent mind, when you're looking at DNA, it's just simply a logical conclusion. It's not some
yes.
God of the
yeah.
gaps argument, or maybe we'll figure it out later on.
Right.
Well, No.
You've reasoned to a conclusion that there must have been intelligence there. It's not that, oh, gee, we don't know.
Right.
It's actually, you reason through to that conclusion.
Exactly. Now, if you're interested in looking into this further, of course, you can go to our website and just go information theory or you know, codes, or you can just punch some keywords in there. But Dr. Werner Gitt, who's an information specialist, has written the book In the Beginning Was Information, which is alluded to there.
Yeah, fascinating.
And I encourage you to get to the website. We've got a whole web store on creation.com, of course, where you can go through. There's kids' resources, technical, if you're involved in the sciences, all that kind of thing. But I really recommend that book to a lot of people. That's
yes.
That's a book I commonly tell people, hey, pick it up.
Now, there are common things. The evolutionists are always pointing out, well, here's some new information, here's new information. You can have massive changes to existing information.
Right.
That's typically what's pointed out.
Right.
There's a mutation somewhere, or something is deleted, and then an entire section of the genome is shifted, and all of a sudden that does something different.
Right.
And we've seen examples of that. And the evolutionists say, well, look, this is all new information now. It's doing
right.
something different. But we're talking about the origin.
Yeah.
How did that information get there to begin with?
Where'd
the code come from? Okay, you can take information and twist it and modify it. No, wow, now it's doing something very different.
Yeah.
But that doesn't explain the origin of the information.
Right.
And fascinating topic, this whole topic of information and where it came from.